Okay.
This is an interview with George Farnum, New York State Military Museum, Saratoga Springs, New York, the 11th of December 2003, approximately 9:30 a.m. Interviewers are Mike Russert and Wayne Clark. Could you give me your full name, date of birth, and place of birth, please?
George Thomas Farnum, born in Brooklyn, New York, April 4th, 1947, U.S. 5162-3930.
All right, thank you. What was your educational background prior to going into the service?
I had 1 year of college.
Okay. Were you drafted or
did I was drafted. You enlist? Actually, kind of volunteered for the draft. I was working for GE, and very eligible for the draft, and tired of working with GE, so I took my physical in August of 67, and that 1A classification. And I was anxious to get this on, so I said, I called the draft board and I said, well, what's going on? And they said, you'd probably call me in November. And I said, can you move it up? So they said, okay, we can take you in September. So I was gone. I had 2 weeks vacation from GE and I was in the military in 2 weeks. It's the middle of September 67.
So did you select the Army?
No, no. They were drafting Army and Marines, so just by chance I got to the Army.
Okay.
God.
Where did you go for your basic training?
Dix, New Jersey, Fort Dix.
How long were you there?
I don't know. Was that usual? Six weeks, eight weeks. Yeah, 6-8 weeks, something like that. Going
back, you know, with your combat, how do you think they prepared you? And
well, it was winter time, you know, and we were playing in the mud and the snow, and we were going into the jungle, and we were constantly told we were going over, you know, just. And that was close to Christmas, too, because I think one of the things they said, don't expect to go home for Christmas, you know, you're going to go who knows where. And nobody knew what their assignment was going to be. There were guys that were signed up for regular Army that were in basic training that were thinking they were going to get an MOS. They were promised an MOS if they signed up. So I took my chances with the draft. I figured, well, I had 1 year of college. Maybe they'll use it. I won't end up in the infantry. Good.
So where'd you go for your AIT?
Jackson, South Carolina. And
infantry?
Yep. Yeah. Advanced infantry training, AIT. And the usual stuff, they want you to go to jump school and stuff like that. Everybody's trying to get the gung-ho guys to go, but I kept a low profile and just did what I had minimum to. I think I did fairly well on the like an aptitude test at the end of AIT, and I got 100 on that. I think that might have saved my butt later on in the military. You try to take tests and be evasive. Do you like to be outdoors? Do you like to go camping? You know, you go, no, you know. Do all the things to try to fool the tests, but that didn't work out either.
Do you think your advanced training helped you at all? What type of advanced training did you receive?
I think they had like map reading and first aid. Those are kind of the two things. And weapons, I mean, you could tear down an M60 or a 45, put it back together, and they do train you on that maintenance of weapons, small arms. I think that helped. Basically, what we weren't prepared for was the difference in the temperature, the winter versus summer type conditions. Mentally, I don't know if I was prepared or not. It was constantly, you were constantly reminded that you were going to Nam. And you got an attitude after a time. You say, what are you going to do to me? Send me to Vietnam? Mm-hmm. If I don't do it, what are you going to do? Send me to Nam? Mm-hmm. And you could see that permeate the whole group of guys. And we all knew we were going. We were told to get a haircut, we wouldn't get a haircut. So what are you going to do to me? You know, that kind of an attitude. But it was pretty amazing how fast we were there. I was, I think I got home before I went over. I'm trying to remember how that happened. I think I was in Jackson, South Carolina, and we got some kind of a leave. It must have been around the Christmas, New Year's time. Mm-hmm. And I took a bus home. And it probably took about 24 hours to take a bus to get home and then go back. But that was the break I got before I went over to Nam. It's right there all the time. It's right there. You know, you can feel it. It's a very emotional thing.
Now, you said you were surprised at how fast you went over there as you returned from leave.
Well, I mean, from the time I went into basic, which was in the middle of, like, September 15th, I think, was when I went in, 67, and I was in Nam, and I had a little diary I kept. I looked back at that the other day, and I think I was somewhere around the middle of March at 68. It was right after 10. You know, I came into Cameron Bay, and everybody said, okay, you're a replacement.
Now you flew in?
Yeah, now he was a civilian aircraft. And I can remember coming into Cameron in the middle of the night and hearing the C-130s, but there was, like, American Airlines jet there, and there was, I was in the Northwest Orient airline. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so it was odd to be in that environment and see all the military aircraft mixed with the civilian aircraft. And in the dark, you have no idea where the heck it was or the scale of the operation, but it was, like, just barely lit. So it was, you couldn't see a heck of a lot.
Whereabouts did you fly out of stateside, Fort Lewis, Washington?
Yeah, Fort Lewis. And we still didn't know where we were going. I knew I was infantry, but I didn't know where I was going to end up.
Yeah, I remember when I flew into Cameron, that's where they assigned everybody out of these.
Lewis?
Well, once you got to Cameron Bay from...
States.
Yeah. From the States, yeah, that's where they assigned everybody.
Yeah, what they call a replacement detachment.
Yeah.
Right. I was trying to remember Lewis a little bit because they did some prep there, too, while we were waiting at Lewis to go over. And I think they gave us some, indoctrination to the culture and the language. They handed out books. I don't know if I ever kept one of those. It was sort of a handbook on translation
from
Vietnamese to, English. Remember that, and then I think probably gotten shots and stuff like that, get prepared our records, medical records, and made sure we were up to date on our shots, and sort of a state of limbo. I'll never forget though, with the first plane we jumped on to go over, the darn thing started on fire, one of the engines. Mm-hmm. We just took off, we were just going out of Washington, and somebody yells, "There's an engine on fire." Everybody went, yeah, we looked out and they started cheering. Everybody's going, yeah. So we got to go over right away. But the thing turned around and went back. And I'll never forget, too, the stewardesses were the ugliest women I've ever seen. I'm sure they did that on purpose, too. I felt sorry for them because everybody was just ringing the buzzers.
Yeah,
ding, ding, ding. Remember that? They just busted
them. They were older women.
Oh, man. And they were running up and down the aisles trying like heck to take, just keep us from going nuts because everybody just had that attitude,
Yeah.
I don't care if this damn plane goes down. And that was pretty amazing. I don't remember where we stopped on the way because I know we made a stop.
Probably Guam. Well, actually,
I want to say Hawaii, and I remember being in Alaska, too.
That's right. When we flew out of Fort Lewis, we flew to Alaska, and then from Alaska to Japan.
Japan?
Yeah. Then
Kadena, was it? No, that was Okinawa.
I don't remember if we stopped in Guam at that point and then went to Vietnam. But I think we may have just went directly from Japan to Vietnam, as I recall.
I remember going to Guam. Because I think I took a couple of flights. I went from Vietnam to Korea and spent some time in Korea, but I made that shuttle a couple of times back and forth, so that's why I'm a little confused which way we went on the way over. Mm-hmm. But, because I'm not sure.
How long was it before you were assigned to a unit?
I think we were in Cameron. No more than a week. It was like a few days. It's 2 to a week.
Yeah, usually it was just a day or two.
Yeah. And But in the meantime, they put you on details, you know, just around filling sandbags. That was the thing to do when you were in Vietnam. If you had nothing else to do, you filled sandbags. So, you know, you either did that, and I can remember one morning getting up, and every morning they assigned you to a detail, and you'd all line up, and you had some kind of an ID card. I guess it was your ID, your military ID. And they would, I think they would collect them to make sure everybody was around, sort of like at a head count. And me and another guy, we just said, well, I'm going to step back so I don't have to give them any detail. So when they went by in the line, we stepped back, and they went by us, right? So that day, they decided to count the ID cards. And they said, okay, we're short for IDs, started getting everybody the dickens. So we put our hands up and said, that was us. And that was my first detail of burning shit. I'll never forget that, man. I just go out there and, did you ever burn shit?
Yeah, I volunteered to do it once so I could say that I had done it.
Oh, my God. So that was that smell in the air, you know, yeah. You know, it was a jet fuel or what it was, but after a while you figured out every morning you were burning diesel fuel or whatever that was that they used.
Smell that never goes away from
you. Oh, no, black smoke and stink. I don't know which worse smelled worse. And the what was the worst part of it is you were burning Vietnamese shit, too, you know. It didn't bother you. It was GI shit. You know, you had guys in there. And yeah, I guess I can show my prejudice and my real feelings during this interview, right?
Yes.
So I guess that's what everybody wants to hear. And I probably still have those prejudices today. I mean, I don't think I'll ever get over it, but that's the way it is. But what I think I would like to do is, because one of the things that I remember the most about that whole transition of going into NAM was how I felt when we first got into that replacement detachment. It was you had these wood barracks, and there wasn't any real walls. It was just like shutters around the outside. Everything was well ventilated, mm-hmm. And we had bunks, and bunks like we had in basic training, and then there was the showers were just basic, elementary wooden, sort of like you'd see in MASH on TV, just plywood boxes and with some kind of shower fixture over your head. And we got mortared while we were in the Cameron, and it was funnier than heck to think back on it later, that what they told us to do is when they had the incoming was to lay on the floor and put your mattress over your head. You know, at that time it seemed like it was made sense, but after being in the field a while and then looking back at that, I was like, what the hell good was that doing anybody, for crying out loud? So yeah, I mean, it was a very quick bang, you're there. And then that first step in the camera, and you felt, holy mackerel, you almost said to yourself, this is combat now, because, you know, you had a taste of it right away, you know. Mm-hmm. It was the crude conditions artillery fire and everything else. And so from there we went to jungle school, which was, once we got assigned to our units, yeah, first thing they said, I got assigned to the 2nd and 12th Cav. And they said, oh shit, man, they really got their asses kicked in Tet. They really got decimated. Boy, those guys are really in the shit all the, you know, that expression of in the shit all the time, you know. They're in the shit all the time. So all the time, you feel like you're going down, down, down. You know, from all the way from the States all the way to Nam. You say, how freaking far down can I go? So, and that's that whole progression going through there. Where it took you is just unbelievable. Do you have questions to ask me, or can I ramble?
No, just...
So we went to, I don't know why I get so emotional about this stuff. I think that's why a lot of guys don't want to do this.
Mm-hmm. Whereabouts was your jungle training? Was it at a base camp with the first cav?
Yeah, on K.
On K.
That's where we went, on K. So that's another part of that trip, you know. How do you get around? How do you get a ride? And I think on that ride, we flew out of Cameron on a Seagull, I want to say a 123. You don't see them around too much anymore. You see the 130s, but the 123s are like a small-scale twin engine, mm-hmm. a cargo. And we flew into on K, and that was an amazing place because Cameron, the field was concrete. It was almost like a civilian airport. It was big scale, monster. I mean, there was constant in and out flights, just civilian, military, just everything was coming and going all the time. When you were waiting for a flight, we called them a hop, you just sitting in these great big, I guess it'd be a hangar building, and there'd be, you'd be on the ground with your gear, and guys would be just all sitting around bullshitting, waiting for a ride, and you'd have your gear sitting on the ground. You always sat on the ground. Once you got numb, you sat on the ground. That was it. That's all you could sit on. Or you squatted like a gook. But I remember the F-4s, all the fighter aircraft, all those guys just constantly in and out. Just unbelievable activity. Unbelievable. So we would just sit there and wait, and then we'd wait and wait and wait. All of a sudden, hey, we got to hop to on K. You know, and everybody going on, anybody was going on K. You'd sit in a group to go to on K. And they'd shuffle you over to an airplane, and you'd jump in that thing and come down on K. So from that activity in Cameron, on K was, how would you call that? The field was, the landing strip was PSP, which is a metal decking that they used that would lay it down so that when it was muddy or wet, I forgot too, it was the weather.
It was always slippery because there's the oil on it.
Yeah, but to come in and land on that, and first time seeing something like that, mm-hmm. what the hell is this stuff, man? So, and this was that next step down, I was thinking, well, okay, now I'm in a, am I in the bush yet? Am I there yet? And thinking you were, you weren't. Because then the next step in those barracks, you didn't have I don't remember having regular bunks. It was a sort of a pole barn, I guess, or, it had a roof over it. I don't remember any walls or anything. I think it just had a wood deck and a roof. I don't think we had mattresses. I don't remember what we slept on. And at Aunt K, they taught us some more about, rappelling. We had a big, tall tower that you would jump off with a rope so that you could repel, if you wanted to repel out of a chopper or something like that. So you were prepared to do that. Everybody had to jump out of that thing, and that was a trip and a half. If you push guys off of that, you'd be in this big, long line all the way up the... on the ground, up, climb up to the top of the tower and wait your turn to go to hell, I guess. And he'd get up there and he'd be guys yelling and screaming, hey, guys would freeze up there and he'd just push you right the hell off the damn thing. And that thing, I can't, I want to guess, I don't know, 60, 80 feet tall. It was pretty tall, so, but it wasn't, once you jumped, it seemed like, I don't remember hurting myself, but there's a lot of guys going through that like a big chain of ants going up and jumping down that stinking thing. Then I don't remember what else we did. Oh, from on K, they also sent us out outside the perimeter for the first time. We went out on an overnight out in Charlie country. And on K, because it was the base of the first K, they had this big hill, and I can't remember the name of that hill that was in on K. But they had a monster first calf patch on that hill. So you could see it from all around. So that, Charlie didn't have any trouble figuring out where the hell we were. But it was pretty scary going out there that first night because, I've never been out there. It was supposed to be outside the perimeter. The perimeter was just basically concertina wire and maybe some bunkers for, with holes, and for guys to pull the perimeter guard. And not K, I called home. I think it was AF, Armed Forces Radio. Armed Forces. I stayed up one night and waited in line. You could sign up and you could call home. And I probably called home.
From the point you landed at the base camp and on K, and you went through an indoctrination training of the area, you went on an overnight. When did you get assigned to your permanent unit? Was it right away at that point?
Well, I knew I was going to 2nd and 12th. Mm-hmm. So that's where I was ultimately headed, and
how long was it before you actually started going out on patrols?
Well, from on K.
Yeah.
So we did that trip, that overnight, and all I remember about that is, we didn't, have any firefights or anything like that. It wasn't, but everybody must have gotten to the same darn position because there was holes dug in this hill, and we just set up like a perimeter, and we were high. I remember being real high. Which you weren't always high, so it was kind of a, I would call it pseudo outside the perimeter situation, but it was mentally, it made you think you were there, I guess. But there was crap all over the place, garbage all over. And it was leftover sea ration cans and some field gear. Just looked like a dirt junk pile. So from there, we jumped on a chopper. I'm not sure we jumped on a, because we had to move in a group. We had to be more than a slick size. There might have been a Chinook, that we took up there. No, it wasn't. It was a Caribou, which is a high wing aircraft. It's similar to it's a cargo plane, but it's a troop carrier, and it loads from the rear. And then I can remember seeing Way, because when we flew up there, we flew over around Way, come into Quantry. We were up like along the coast to do that one, and that was a pretty weird trip. I don't remember taking on any kind of fighting or anything like that. So when we land in Quantry, they just dumped us in a bomb crater. A couple of craters there. And we're outside Quantry, and we had to come in, so we came in with that one, with that Caribou, and it had to be, because I don't remember the airfield we landed on. It had to be just a quick strip right outside of Quantry, and I don't think we took a truck maybe to this, it was a pad, it was just a helipad outside the roadway. It must have been Route 1 right, that ran up through there, Quantry. And I remember laying in this hole, a bunch of us waiting to go out to the unit, to our unit. And that was that next progression from this bunk to no bunks to no showers. The next thing was the dirt. And and we just sat there, and they sent a couple of slicks, UEs out from the fire base we were going to, and they picked us up there and brought us into the fire base. And that was LZ Jane. And I guess that was the bottom. I was as bad as it got, as far as living conditions. But I remember first about Jane was that everything we had, we were carrying with us. And they said, you guys can't carry all that crap. You just got to get rid of something. You can't physically carry everything. Because what you got is what you got with you is what you're going to keep, and that's all you're going to have, and you better have what you're going to carry. And we don't want anybody loaded down so that with shit that's not necessary. Mm-hmm. So we just, they had this tent there that we just kind of stripped, you know, took everything. I gave up my camera, I gave up, you know, that's a big thing I remember. I had a little Instamatic. That was a big deal back then. Everybody carried an Instamatic. But you didn't have film, but you carried the camera anyway. So that from there, then I was assigned to a company in 2nd and 12th. So I was assigned to Delta Company. And that was a rifle squad, rifle platoon, I guess you'd call it. And we set up, we pulled perimeter guard on Jane. And, you know, it's just mortars all the time. You know, the gooks are always screwing with you. You know, just kind of lived with it, you know. So we would be on perimeter guard. When we weren't on perimeter guard, we'd go out and do sweeps in the bush. And you never knew what you were gonna do, actually. So we'd go out, we'd be out maybe a week or 10 days and make a sweep, come back in, pull perimeter. And that was the whole routine, you know. Sometimes you get it in some firefights, sometimes you wouldn't. You just, like, after a while you just kind of stripped yourself down, because I don't think I wore any underwear. I didn't have socks, because we were out there, we didn't get resupplied. I can remember times we didn't have any water. I can remember drinking rice paddy water. You're supposed to have like these purification tabs to put in the water. We never got those. You know, I remember humping one day all day with a freaking leech in my boot. That son of a bitch was right there by my ankle. I said, "You bastard." That thing was there all day while I was walking. And we finally set up for the night, took my boot off and just smashed him to nothing. The attitude of the guys was just sad. I mean, one guy wanted me to shoot him in the hand to get out of the field. We had a 60 gunner that shot himself in the thigh to get out. You'd see firefights or mortar attacks where guys were just, like, not really covering themselves.
Just hoping to get hit?
Yeah, get a frag, get $1 million wound. You see, and then we were supposed to take malaria tabs, too. You wouldn't take your malaria tab. Doc would go around, take your salt. Another thing, oh, you're taking salt. I guess we were supposed to be losing it from the sweat. It was dirty, miserable, nasty, son of a bitch in place, though. God damn it. It's like everything was against you, every friggin' thing. The weather, the bugs, everything.
Now, how long did that routine last where you'd go out on patrol, come back, and do perimeter guard? Did you do that basically for months on end?
Yeah, I mean, that went on. I gotta put this thing back together chronologically, because this is all, like, fuzzy here. I remember pieces, and I don't remember the chronology of how it happened.
It's okay if you don't remember.
Yeah, some of it, sometimes I wonder if it really happened, you know? I'm saying to myself, well, was I dreaming that, or did I make it up? Because you're sitting around sometimes with the guys, and you're shooting a breeze today, mm-hmm. and you wonder how much of this is embellished, or how much of it really happened, or... But, you can't take away that goddamn feeling.
Did you get an R&R while you were over there?
There's something I was going to say. I didn't get an R&R. And I'll try to tell you why. Just had this flash of these bodies with flies. There's big fucking flies. I've never seen flies so big. They were, you know, whenever there was bodies around, that stink, and then you had these flies. I mean, they were just... try to eat something.
I remember those flies. You'd have to physically pull them out of your food because they just wouldn't fly away.
Big son of a piece. But and the ways you improvise ways to cook, you know, you have take a sea ration can and take a punch holes in it and use it for a stove. We used to break the
C4.
Yeah, break the claymores and get the C4 out of it. And then we'd take a little piece of C4 and light that and put our coffee on it. Heat our coffee in the morning or heat the sea rations or something like that. Some guys were real good cooks. They could improvise and mix stuff just out of the sea rations. Mm-hmm. We had one expression, you know, I turned 21 when I was in Nam. In fact, actually, I turned 21 in Quezon. I got to get this thing in order somehow. I can't remember what happened, when, which way. Well, let's just say something. The Cav went to Quezon. We shipped everything. One day, there's a whole bunch of activity, and they got shit hooks came in from all over. Everybody started loading on the shit hooks and started going. And nobody knew where we were going. And we were flying low, and just through the valleys.
Could you explain what that term means?
What?
Shit hook.
Shit hook.
In case someone watching this in the future.
Oh, that's a Chinook helicopter. Okay. That's a transport helicopter. It's two rotors on it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had them. Wow, this stuff's coming back. I even forgotten about.
Did your whole unit ship up to Quezon?
Never see anything like it. Never see anything like it. So the Chinooks, we all, there was, I couldn't tell you how many. All I know is we were flying so low. We went into another fire base, a big, big fire base. It wasn't much. It wasn't anything like it was set up in a perimeter or anything like that, but it was a place for everybody to come in and get dropped. So the Chinooks kept coming in and dropping guys, and we assembled in groups in our units. And there were mountains of sea rations. Mountains. I mean, a pile of sea rations probably half as big as this armory. And everybody was just raping them. That was an expression we used. We called a rape. Rape a case of C's. So you would go in, if you got a whole case of C's to yourself, you could get what you wanted out of there. Otherwise, you got the last pickings. But that was like a little bit of heaven to get your own case of C's so you can rip it open and pick what you wanted out of there and get the primo stuff.
What did you consider primo?
Oh, I'm trying to think. I like the veg. There's a cocktail sauce. There's chicken, bone chicken. You get all the cigarettes you wanted because who came with packs of cigarettes, and, different kinds. Then you got, like, I think, toilet paper would be, but there's little brown bags that had the sundry, like a sundry pack. That was another one of those things, a sundry pack. I think that was had the cigarettes and toilet paper. There was other cases with cheese in them, cans. There was some really ugly stuff. What the heck was it? Spaghetti and hot dogs, I think it was. I couldn't imagine how they even came up with that concoction.
Beans and meatballs, and there
beans
was
beans and meatballs.
There was eggs and lima beans.
Oh man!
Yeah, there were some horrible combinations.
I ended up with a cyst over there. In fact, that's when I was in Quezon. Right on my rectum. It was so bad that I couldn't stand up, I couldn't sit down, I couldn't walk, I couldn't do anything. They shipped me out of there because of that. I was in, after we went to Quezon, maybe I should keep on going. How much time do we have here?
As much as you need.
Holy mackerel.
Now, when you were in Quezon, that was after the Marines had pulled out?
They were there, and then we came in to bust them out. Okay. So we set up all around there. We got all kinds. I mean, that was the hottest action I got. There was rockets, snipers. I remember coming in on the chop. So after I forgot the Timothy story. So after we got to Timothy, then the slicks started coming in and the Cobras. So we went out, picked us up because you were like six men on a chopper. So maybe our company was took six choppers or something like that. I remember getting on that freaking chopper, and I was the last guy in, and I could just barely fit. I had my legs dangling outside, trying to hang on like this, looking out. And we just kept coming in. I was like running into a swarm of yellow jackets. It was like that many birds in the air. I mean, there had to be, I want to guess, 500 choppers in the air. I mean, that was a whole, I think it was a whole battalion moving that way. And we just, they just kept taking us, coming in, heading us out to Quezon. And we were flying high, I mean really high. And I'm hanging out of the DLT, I'm going like this, come on you guys, don't move, you know, I'm going to take a jump out of this thing. From there, they set us down on the hills around Quezon. We all came in and dropped. And I was on the edge, so I was the first guy out of the chopper. And I'm, oh, we had, they loaded us down with sandbags, too, on that trip. So we had picks, we had shovels, we had sandbags, we had all our gear, we had our ammo. I was a 60 gunner, assistant gunner. I had 60 ammo, two bandoliers of 60. I carried 4 gallons of water, I mean four canteens of water. I carried a claymore, my C's, sandbags that day. I carried as many frags as I could get on me, all I could carry. I think I had 16 clips of 16 ammo. When you had to put your rack on, what was my rucks, what they call the rucksacks, they call them racks, you'd lay on the ground, get in it like this, roll over, get on your fours, and then stand up like this, and then hump. And you had a shovel, sometimes you had a shovel. That would help you get along like that. Wait a minute, vines. I don't know if you guys heard of wait a minute, vines. But we were sort of what they call the foothills of those mountains. And this had to be before, you know, one of these patrols. Mm-hmm. And you get into the jungle where you start going up into the mountains, and they had these vines that would catch on everything you did. Your ass would be dragging, you're trying to walk, and these freaking vines would be grabbing you all the time. Oh, gee, you bastard. And we called them, so after that's how we got the expression, wait a minute, vines, because you'd be tangling, wait a minute, you know, going like that, so you're trying to get through the damn things, you know. And leeches. So then we'd take a break and make sure there was always that separation, make sure you kept your separation, make sure you, you know, kept the noise down. But you were walking in a dream. You had all that weight, you didn't give a shit, and you were like almost hallucinating when you were walking, and especially in the heat. You weren't in your body, you were just there. Then you take a break and set up. You wouldn't set up, you'd just take a break and sit down, and you're in that jungle. They had ground leeches. They had water leeches, they had ground leeches. You had to check yourself for ground leeches all the time, because those bastards, they're little tiny ones. So if you sat down on the ground for any period of time, you could be guaranteed to have a couple leeches on you. So we used to have to check each other for leeches every once in a while. So anyway, on that flight, when we came out of Timothy, I can't remember the hill number. There was a number on that hill. I wrote it down someplace. And that was just what I remember most about Quezon. It looked like just big piles of dirt. You could see where the B-52s had been through. Just these big poom, poom, just like the moon craters. That's all there was. It was dirt with craters, dirt with craters, dirt with all over. Hardly ever any green. It just defoliated everything around there. I can remember some green spots down on outside in like the low areas, but it was pretty much just stripped. Bombing, napalm, whatever, everything, all the defoliants, Agent Orange, I mean, all that stuff. And then, but in the craters, there'd be water. I mean, it'd be dead buffalo in the crater, water buffalo in the craters. They'd get in there and wouldn't get drink or couldn't get out or some damn thing. They died in there. So we're coming into this hill, and you're hearing click, click, click. So they're sniping at us, you know, somebody, just small arms coming in. And every once in a while, they're whew, whew. And the cobras were up there working out all around us. They were just constant. They were shooting rockets. It was just shit flying all over the place. So I'm looking down and we're ready to jump, and I'm the first one out. And I'm looking down, and we're right over the tops of this grass. And it was a buffalo grass on top of this hill. And I just said it was just denuded, but there's this grass there for some freaking reason. And I'm ready to first one out. So somebody said, jump! So I jumped, and I hit this grass, and I didn't stop. I just kept going and going. I swear that crap had to be 20 feet tall. I thought I was on the ground when I got to that. No. And pop, boom! And the next thing I know, boom, boom! The next guy hits me on top of him. Boom, boom! We're all just kind of boom, boom, boom! And the rockets are coming in. Boom, boom, boom! What the fuck is going on? One hit from probably, I don't know, 30 feet from here. I remember the sergeant grabbed me and said, get your ass down, you stupid son of a bitch. He threw me down the hill. We're laying there. The shit's still flying around. We were crawling. I was trying to get my stuff together and trying to find a place to hide. And there was a finger on this hill, kind of like an L shape. And you couldn't tell the friendly fire from the gooks firing. So there was, you just kind of like scrambling, digging. You know, sometimes you felt like digging with your hands just to get the hell out of the way. And so I found a hole, a crater, and I got in that. A couple of us guys got in there. So we felt kind of protected in there. And but there still was a lot of, stuff going on. The choppers started bringing stuff in. They brought in, I remember, a couple of bladders of water. They sat right on top of the damn hill. And blivets, I guess they call them. But, so we kind of waited, because there was still more assembly going on, and I remember opening up a can of sea rations, getting something to eat, believe it or not. I don't know how I did that. And then they kind of came back and said, okay, we got to set up holes, and they started putting a few guys together in positions, and we had to dig in, and we dug. I was going to guess. It was unusual. There was six of us, because usually we had three guys on a hole. And we used to pull guard, take turns pulling guard. You would sleep 2 hours and guard for 1 hour. So we just rotate through the night. You never really slept, because, you like had one eye open or something, but it's hard to sleep. But you knew that you had 2 hours sleep, you had an opportunity to do it that way anyway. But on this case, they put six of us together and told us to start digging. Because we had all those sandbags, so they must have figured we were gonna set up a pretty good position for a while and be there for a while. Most of the time, you just dug a hole. You didn't have any sandbags or anything. You just had an overnight position and then move on the next day. So we just figured we were gonna be staying for a while. And that first night, we had all set and done digging with this hole. We had steps going down in it, and we're setting up. For the night, I don't remember how we did the perimeter on that, who was doing watch. But the way it ended up, I couldn't fit in the hole. I had to sleep on, I got stuck on the steps, on the side there. So it was like, everybody's down in, low, and I'm on freaking steps. So I said, hey, wait a minute, you guys, what's going on? How the hell am I going to cover my ass? And everybody just kind of looked at me, I don't know. So I said, fuck you. I asked everybody for their frags. So I put all the frags I could get behind me. Because we could see lights out in the valley. There was movement out there. Things were going on. Still getting rocket fire. In fact, that night, there was an air burst. And we were, on that finger, I was where I went down there on that hole. We came back and moved. A rocket came in, hit a tree. And the frags came down and hit the mortar platoon's cache. And started setting off rounds. Boom, 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 boom. Holy crap. I remember our sergeant running down to see what happened. And I guess three guys got it that and that one. And maybe there was a couple guys. I remember him saying something, 3KA, 2WA, blah, 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 something like that. And he said, yeah, right. But anyway, so that night, I spent the whole freaking night throwing hand grenades. Anything that moved, I threw it. In fact, one time I had to go out there and reset a trip, which was When we cleared our spot, it was only from the whole, you can imagine a wall like that wall, but it was maybe back another 10 feet, and that how far we got cleared. So right there was that wall of elephant grass right there in front of the hole. And we set up trip flares out in the elephant grass before it got dark. And during the night, one of those trip flares went off. The sergeant goes, "Farnum, get out there and reset that trip." I said, "Man, me, I think it was Coocher went out with me." And he had the weapon, and we just kind of crawled out there, snuck out there. Who the hell, we didn't know what the hell we were going to get into. We didn't run into any gooks, thank God, but I don't know what set that trip. It was kind of windy. And we got back in, and then that's the rest of that night. I can remember throwing hand grenades at everything that frickin' moved. And I never slept that night. I think everybody else got a chance to sleep. Made it through that night, and then the morning, everybody else was screwing around. I said to him, "Man, I got to get some sleep, you know." So that was my 21st birthday. No, my present for my 21st birthday was a case of sea rations. They let me rape a case of seas for my birthday. So anyway, I fell asleep on a pile of sandbags. And the next thing I can remember is a fire in front of me. I woke up and a freaking fire. Sandbags caught on fire. I must have fallen asleep with a cigarette in my hand. And it started a fire. I swear to God. That's a whole other part of this thing. They're going to kill me one freaking way or another. I ain't coming out of here alive. I'm done. This is it, man. They're going to get me. So every day, with that feeling you had not every day, you could define it in minutes and hours. I mean, if you had to live with that feeling every freaking minute, it changes you. It just changes you. Expressions we used to use, man, I get hit today, it would really piss me off. Or, boy, it would ruin my whole freaking weekend if I got hit today. You know, just this callous, indifferent attitude about, you know, getting wounded or getting hurt. No attachments to anybody. You know the guys. I mean, I could hardly remember any names right now for some of the guys I was with. There's a couple of guys in my hole. One guy was a black guy, and his name was Styles. I'd like to run into him again. Then there's another guy. He was from the South. Styles was from New York City. I remember one time on a fire base, we used to have these mad minutes. It was like an exercise or a practice for just preparedness. Make sure you get everything ready. And what would happen at a certain time, the mad minute, you would just open up with everything you got to try to let Charlie know that you guys were still there and this is what the firepower was. So you could just, everybody be just out throwing stuff and open up. We had quad 40s on our fire base. They had small artillery, you know, so you'd open up with everything. Just, and they called it a mad minute. But one time we took a canister of CS and threw it. And the wind was blowing just right and it blew right across the fire base. And raised heck with everybody. Is it tear gas? Yeah. That went across the choppers. Because we had small, you know, like slicks and on that fire base too. And they were set up with sandbags on the side to protect them. They'd land in between so that if they had mortar attacks or anything, mortar rounds coming in, that the choppers would be protected. But that was fun watching that CS go across the choppers. Everybody scrambling. Did stupid things.
You said in your forum here, you said that you thought camp life was lonely. Do you think it was because there were no attachments developed, or?
Well, you never knew when you were going to hear from home either. So you just, I guess it was being away from home. You didn't have any real attachments to anybody. You did that intentionally. And like you had said earlier, when the units in World War II left, they left in groups, mm-hmm. You know. They know each other. There was a whole company probably, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we just, when we got into Albany, there was a few guys from the Albany area when we left for basic training. But then eventually you just got split up along the way and never really stayed together.
Mm-hmm. How'd you feel about the rotation system? You had guys rotating in and out all the time.
I don't remember it that well. Mm-hmm. What I was going to say is that I got wounded on one of the... that's where I don't remember the order. But it had to be after Quezon. We were out on patrol. We set up for the night. And it was like on a flat, almost like a plain. There really wasn't that much protection. We weren't on high ground or anything. And I can remember hearing some boom, 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 boom. And I was on guard that night because I was sitting like this. And the hole was only about a foot and a half. The ground was like a hard clay. It was pink. You could dig in, but it would take you forever because it was hard to dig deep. So we didn't dig very deep that night. And I was sitting on the edge of the hole like this, kind of watching the flares or whatever else was going on, just fire, whatever, you know, just watching the world. And the guys, my hole, were sleeping behind me. And I heard those pops. We had set up the clay, we had everything else set up. Boom, 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 boom. And after a while, what big deal, you know, a couple of pops, boom, boom, boom. And then they started coming in. But it sounded like they were far enough away so I didn't have to worry about it for some reason. I don't know if I was half asleep or what. And then all of a sudden, bang! I felt like somebody kicked me in the side. And I said, "You son of a..." And I had a hole in me. Jesus Christ, that was it. And I jumped in the hole. I don't know why. And the other jerks tried to get in there too. And I'm not gonna go, "You better get off me, I'm hitting you, jerk." So, but I think it hit the command post. I think they hit the command post because now it's just a blur. I got hit. I think a few other guys got hit. And they sent us back to the fire base. And they put us in a tent for the night because I guess they couldn't take us anywhere and couldn't treat us. And they made us stay in that tent until it got daylight. It's about 11 or 12 o'clock at night that I hit. And I figured I was a goner on that one.
And, you had no medical treatment at all?
No, I put like a band-aid on me. So I can't, you know, it was like not really anything. So I just kind of, I couldn't lay down because it hurt so much. I couldn't. So I just kind of like wandered around on the fire base until it got daylight. Those other guys that were hit worse than I was, but I remember they were bandaged, I think. They had to do something with them, right? Because they took us out with a medevac. I remember when the medevac came in, I was laying on the ground. And I'm looking up, and I thought it was going to land on me. I freaked out, because all I could see was this big red cross. And I'm yelling, "It's going to land on me, it's going to..." The guys are trying to hold me down, because he must have come in like real low, like over like that, and landed inside the perimeter. And I thought they were going to get me that time, and with a chopper was going to get me. All the time you're thinking, something's, you know, I ain't making it, I'm going somehow. But anyway, so we got there, and waited till the morning. And the doc comes around to check us. He says, "What's the matter with you?" I said, "There he is here, man." He goes, "You see?" He looks at it and he goes, "Oh, that?" Boom! And he punched right in the thing on the side. I went, "Jesus Christ, you son of a bee!" Starts bleeding. I started coughing blood. Because I felt like I was hitting a heart. Went straight in, like in, right in here, like the size of maybe a dime. I call that $1 million wound now. But, so then he sends me over to this other section in the tent, and they gave me an IV. And then, you know, I'm laying there, and they can put the IV in. They said, "Okay, here." And they hand me the IV bottle. I go, "What the hell am I supposed to do with this?" She said, "Well, go get on the chopper." So here I am walking over the freaking chopper, like my own IV like that. Put me on the chopper. And then they sent us to, an evac hospital. And it was... I don't know how many guys were there, 4 or 5 guys. And one guy got his guts, you know, hit here. And I mean, just what a fucking bloody mess that was. You want to see something? You want to see one of those hospitals? What bothered me more than anything else about that was, that hospital was an air tent. It was like an air building. I held it up with air. I think that was in, I don't know where it was. It wasn't far from our fire base. And then they took my boots, and that pissed me off. They dug that thing out with a local anesthetic. They just took, they're all over. The doctor's all, every blood all over. Everybody's covered. Just took a thing and just started digging. I'm going, just out of yelling and screaming. I said, you son of a, I swear he was digging in my heart. And he just took it out and he gave it to me. And I saved that frag. I think I sent it home with my Purple Heart, and I don't know where it went. And then I got pissed off because they took my boots. And the boots were like a cherished thing because you, when you get them new, they're tough to break in. And these guys were really in good shape. They were like nice soft gloves, you know. So I was fighting to find my boots, and then I had to start all over again with a new pair of boots. But anyway, from there, I went down to another hospital, and my brother John was in country. I knew he was in country. In fact, he was in basic training behind me when I was in Dix. And I don't know how many weeks behind he was, maybe six, four, it had to be 4 weeks, it could have been six, but it was similar. And we did see each other once in basic training. But anyway, I knew he was in Nam, so I went to the chaplain, and am I getting too long-winded?
No.
That's right, keep going.
The chaplain found my brother, and he showed up at the evac hospital. And he snuck in a pair of fatigues, and we snuck out, went downtown Punyan. I wasn't supposed to be. I'm walking like this. I can hardly stand up. And had a hamburger. He showed me the town a little bit. But ultimately what happened is he got in touch with his commanding officer, and his commanding officer got paperwork started for me to get out of Nam because two of us were in country at the same time. And John was in, my brother John was in engineer battalion in Quinyan, and he said, oh, I'm all right, you know, you get out of here. With me crying about not making it through this one, he said, well, why don't you get out of here? So his CO helped me push, because after I got wounded, they sent me back to my unit. And my first sergeant said, Top, I said, I'm not going back out in the bush. And he says, what do you mean, you pussy? He said, no, I'm not going out in the bush, I'm getting out of here. Oh, you are like, oh. But he made me, for some reason, so then I got to the company clerk, and I got in touch with my brother again, and he sent a letter back to my unit, told the first sergeant to get me, to send me out of here. But in the meantime, I had to fill sandbags until, you know, we got all that straightened out, but I'll never forget that sergeant called me a wimp whisk for not going back out in the field. So that, from there, they sent me to Korea, and I thought they were going to put me in the Z up there, and I was ready to go shoot the Z up in Korea. And believe it or not, I ended up being a curator of a museum in Korea, the 7th Division Museum. So I did that for the rest of my tour and got lucky. Now I'm back out on the street. I don't know if I should. Yeah.
We're down to four.
So yeah, and then after getting out, it was, I felt like I was very lucky because I only really spent about 2 years. It was less than 2 years active duty. I did 15 months overseas, plus my basic training and advanced infantry training. So I think I had maybe 18 months active, 18, 19 months active, maybe more.
So you got an early out then?
Yeah, if you had done 15 months overseas, you could get, and had less than 5 months to go, mm-hmm. You get an early out. So that got me out, and then put me back out on the street, and that I just kind of like wandered for a while. Oops. Excuse me. And ended up getting a job and going through that whole era there where the candlelight vigils and the protests, and because it had to be around 1969, around in there, and. I remember being part of the protest, too, because I wasn't really in favor. I wanted that thing to be over. And I didn't see any more guys getting killed. It was really a disillusioning to be so idealistic to go in the first place and feel you're going to do what you thought was right. And then go over there and fight and find out what you did, what you were doing was kind of futile because we weren't gaining anything. We didn't see any real ground being gained. You know, there was... We'd go out and hit the same place again and again and again. We didn't take anything. We didn't hold anything. Maybe Cameron, the bigger places. I'm not even sure we had them. But all in all, if I had to stop and think about it, I'd do it again. I'm not feeling like I was a sucker. I don't feel like I did the wrong thing. It was a necessary thing. What was the alternative? I'm thinking about it right now, the way things are, is do we just sit around and wait for them to hit us? And I don't think that's the way to go. After being overseas and seeing those countries and seeing how people were living under those conditions, I think everybody should go over there and see what's going on in the rest of the world. And no comprehension. We're spoiled rotten, stinking rotten. We have everything compared to those countries. And maybe we should be doing something.
Do you ever have much interaction with the Vietnamese people?
No. No.
Down about 25 seconds.
No.
I'll go to a second
tape. Yeah, because in Korea was
why don't you stop? We're going to go to
So I just had a thought about the transition from Vietnam to Korea. I was thinking about the girls, but I better not talk about that. Do guys talk about that stuff?
Some do.
that was something else.
What whereabouts in Korea were you stationed apart?
Camp Casey, which would be, I think it was Tongdushan, a small village. It was north of Seoul, about halfway between Seoul and the DMZ. And the patch for the 7th Division was an hourglass, a red and black hourglass. And the unit I got assigned to was the ISO detachment, and I'm not sure what that stands for, I forgot, something services. But essentially what that group did was maintain the NCO clubs. It was part of a headquarters company, and it was a cush job. I mean, we had our own little compound, our own movie theater. We were the aide to the company commander. Was all the officers lived there for the compound. So it was, and that's why I think that the marks I did, I had achieved in AIT, that good results in AIT, probably helped make that decision of me getting that job in Korea, you know. So maybe for one thing I did right in the whole dang trip was use my brain a little bit. And that, because I thought for sure, because I had training in infantry, that they would put me right up there on the Z. But they must have known that I would have, because it's so restricted up in Korea that everything is, don't fire unless you're fired upon. You know, and just having used to be in a free fire situation, they probably knew I would probably mess public relations up or do something like that. But anyway, they thought I would be in public relations. And when I was in charge of the museum, there was somebody they wanted, somebody with combat experience. And what I would do was, you had starch uniforms. I made, I made E-5 when I was in Korea. And so you had a CIB, you're kind of shit. Because most of those guys hadn't had combat. Here we are going with a combat, non-combat trip. But, I would take guys that were coming into Korea. What do they call them? It's sort of part of their indoctrination was to tour this museum, and I had to learn about the Korean War as much as I could so I could walk people through the museum and explain the war. That was interesting. And I also was in charge of reports of survey. And what they were if a guy lost his gear, web gear, even a Jeep, if it was missing or was stolen, there was a report made out and there were claims made that sometimes even felt that the GI is responsible. So we would have to make out these reports, and it was a joke pretty much. And most of the guys were already out of service. They were civilians. And we were sending them these letters that they were reliable for these missing items. It was goofy. So we do that every day. We had a tickler file and go through, and you had a form 1, 2, 3, and you just go through it updated. It was nuts. But Korea, being in Korea, my first impression of that was it reminded me of Vietnam 20 years later. It was the same sort of environment, the foliage, the topography. It reminded me of Vietnam. And a lot of the Vietnamese and Koreans ran, like our detachment, the whole base was pretty much run by Koreans. They did the maintenance, the road work, the repairs. And right outside the base, you'd see people washing their clothes in the river. You know, it was just, they had a golf course there. Then you'd see the people outside living in, we called it the cracks. It was just a narrow ribbon between the buildings, and they were just mud. There was nothing to them, you know, just no plumbing, stunk. I mean, just every, you know, in the springtime, they just put human waste on the fields. But you know, they seemed happy.
Were you there for the winter in Korea? Or?
Yeah. So it was similar to, I would call it, if you look at it, what the latitude there, mm-hmm. it's very close to Washington, D.C., or, you know, up, like a, it was similar to our weather. Mm-hmm. I don't remember it quite as cold, but they had quite a bit of snow. A lot of the guys had fought in Korea, you know. Tangdusheng, was it in Chosin Reservoir? And I know a guy that was there. I'd like to get him over here to talk about this.
What, did you ever have any contact with South Vietnamese soldiers at all when you were in South Vietnam?
Arvins?
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't remember anything. I don't remember very much contact at all with the civilians other than considering that everyone to us was the enemy and we didn't have any friendlies, let's call it, on that. Our attitude was, you know.
Were you the only one in your platoon with any college or?
I don't know.
How about race relations within your unit?
I know in basic training it was a lot of tension. And actually just being from New York, you got labeled. You know, there was this sense of anybody from New York was a smart ass and a troublemaker, especially to the drill instructors or anybody, you know, that were, you know, during the training, DIs and those guys, you're, hey, New York boy. They gave you that, you had that label no matter what, if you were from New York City or from Buffalo or wherever. But then, but there was a lot of fighting in basic training between the whites and the blacks. We resented the Puerto Ricans because of the Spanish, and that was basically because they didn't speak any English. And you always had this feeling they were talking like about you, you know? So, mm-hmm. and they, so that always created some friction. In Vietnam, yeah, there was friction between the whites and blacks, but it was like, it was amazing to me, like black guys would carry, they'd be carrying their radios or they had cassette players. No matter where the hell they went, they'd always have their cassette player. I mean, you talk about carrying stuff, I mean, that was one of their bare essentials. They probably wouldn't carry food, they'd carry that. I don't know, but I was, you know, my platoon, my squad leader was black, Thompson. I mean, I didn't have any trouble with them. I didn't know. It's not, you know, it was just different personalities, no matter what color they were. And we called people niggers when they were white. You know, there was white niggers and black niggers. I mean, it had that name was used not just so much for a black person, but for a personality trait, let's call it. But, and there was a lot of friction. There was gay guys. I had a gay guy grab me by the ass once in a hole. We were sitting up in a perimeter. Jeez, man, what's going on? You know, I said, I just scooted out of there, but I could have probably shot him. I could have killed him. You know, he had the opportunity to do it. It just, I don't know, it was a relatively new thing to me, but probably, you know, they talk about fragging sergeants and, you know, that happened. I mean, it was just a pretty nasty situation. In Korea, you could end up dead in no time because if you went in the wrong spot at the wrong time, the North Koreans or the South Koreans would take care of you. You know, if they didn't like you, you'd disappear. And they had a status of forces agreement in Korea where if you did something wrong, you could be tried under Korean law. Mm-hmm. So everybody was fairly careful about what they did. I don't remember anything like that in Vietnam. I guess that was just kind of a mm-hmm. do whatever you want kind of an atmosphere. Our attitude was shoot first and ask questions later. So we just didn't take any chances on who was who. And we were never, I was hardly ever in any situation where I was in a, other than while I was traveling, maybe in a, I went through the larger towns. Most of the time we were out in the rural areas. So I didn't have much time to socialize.
How do you feel about Jane Fonda?
At the post, we've got a urinal sticker. We have
that. We have that up in our office.
So that's how I feel about Jane Fonda. Piss on her.
You joined veterans organizations?
Yes. You know what? I don't think I did that right after getting out. Mm-hmm. When I first got out, I had a one-year membership to the VFW, which I never went to a meeting because there was still that feeling that, you know, you guys didn't really fight a war. And I didn't really care. It seems that the World War II vets, only because probably they don't have the numbers, are more accepting of us. But if you got into the down and dirty, they probably have the same feeling. You know, you guys didn't really fight a war. The big one is what they mm-hmm. used, the big one. We weren't in the big one. But probably in the 80s is when I started to feel like I wanted to be involved, and I get involved with the Vietnam Vets of America, and I was like a treasurer and a president, and held a couple of the offices, and that just fell apart because of the internal conflicts of the veterans. They just couldn't agree on anything. And from there, I felt like I wanted to do something, so I got involved with the VFW. And through the Saratoga VFW, Jack Eckert, he helped me get life membership, and then eventually because I live in Malta, that I transferred down to Ballston Spa and got involved there. I've been a commander for a couple of years and quartermaster. And I'm the chaplain right now. But, I stay active with the veterans organizations.
Now, I know you alluded to this, but you never stayed in contact with anyone that you served?
No.
Have you ever gone to any reunions or thought about any reunions attending any?
I went to one for the first Cav a few years ago. My brother John did a second tour in Vietnam, and he was in the Cav on that tour, so he and I are both former members of the Cav, so we went to a Cav reunion. Mm-hmm. And we didn't appeal to us particularly. We were looking for people, and we went to a couple of years ago, was a Vietnam Vets stand down in Boonville, and that turned out to be fairly neat. And my brother John ran into a guy that he was with in Quinyan. But I've never found anybody that was in my unit. I joined the 1st Cav Division Association and actually sent a little bit of email stuff to try to put feelers out to see if anybody was out there. And actually, I literally even have trouble remembering names because it's that kind of fuzzy area that I'm not sure who I'd be looking for. Mm-hmm. You know, I can almost. And in fact, I had a few pictures. And they've disappeared, so I don't have any real. Mm-hmm. I kept a diary for a while. I've got that.
I was going to ask, how long did you keep that?
I think after I got wounded, where I had an opportunity to buy mm-hmm. something, and then some of it was recreated, and then some of it was, you know, as it went along, so that. It's like half the tour, probably half the time mm-hmm. I was there.
Do you ever watch many Vietnam movies at all? Any movies?
Yeah, I've watched Platoon and Full Metal Jacket. And
do you have one that you thought was more realistic than others?
I haven't seen one that really recreated the look, mm-hmm. but I think Platoon kind of recreated the feel.
You didn't come down like Apocalypse Now with all the mm-hmm. things.
No, but that was an attitude.
Yeah,
it was there,
yeah,
definitely,
right.
I mean, that did show a little taste of that attitude, you know. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if people would read that out of that whole mm-hmm. sequence, you know. Mm-hmm. But that attitude still exists. I mean, I think I still have that attitude. There's an attitude that you get because it's almost like you're invincible. You know, that's how you feel after a while. You feel like you're immortal. You know, you go through this. And then there's another part of it that makes you feel guilty because you did make it and the other guy didn't. Mm-hmm. So that's where all those contradictions of emotions all kind of run together. And if you can sort it out, I suppose you're a little ahead of the game, but I think there are guys that just can't sort that out. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe because I didn't do a whole 12 months I got an edge. I don't know, maybe I would have been in worse shape if I had spent the whole tour over there. I don't know if it depends on how much exposure you had to combat makes a difference. I imagine it does.
How do you think
every man had his own trip, you know?
Yeah. How do you think your time there changed or affected your life?
Well, I don't know, I have a deep sense of pride that I don't have to show that makes me feel good. Mm-hmm. And I know I've always got it, and it's something that nobody can take away from me. And I also know that it gives you a better sense of the value of life. I think it gives you a greater appreciation. It's annoying to watch people just be bothered by such little things, and you know, it's you know, it's amazing to what can be a problem to somebody. To actually, you know, probably beg for your life. You pretty much beg for it. And then you live it, and you go, how the, now what do I do? You know, I got my wish, and now I better do something with it. It's sort of, what was that one? It was like, there was one good movie, Make It Worthwhile. What was that one? It's a World War II movie with a Saving Private Ryan. Oh. And that was the hardest part of it to me at the end of that movie, where they're sitting at the cemetery and go, make it worthwhile, you know.
Did you make use of the GI Bill when you got
out? Oh, yeah. I'm an architect right now. I got my license with the aid of the GI Bill. And I didn't get licensed till I was 37. But I went back to school when I was 30. And but all I ultimately ended up with was an associate's degree. And the rest of my time, I was able to acquire by practical experience and qualify to take the exam for an architect's license. And that's how I ultimately ended up being an architect, with the aid of the GI Bill, I would say. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your interview.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.